YouTube, Edgar here, and welcome to Artifexian. Here you will learn everything you ever wanted to know about world building, and then some. Kuiper Belt objects come in five distinct dynamical classes. Resonant objects, classical Kuiper Belt objects, scattered disk objects, detached objects, and finally, sednoids. In this video, let's look at building an orbit for a resonant Kuiper Belt dwarf planet. So first up, let's define resonant. Two objects are said to be in mean motion resonance when their orbital periods can be represented by the ratio of two small integers. 1 is to 2, 2 is to 3, etc. Example, planet A here has an orbital period of 30 years and is in a 2 to 3 mean motion resonance with B, as it has a 45 year orbital period. Similarly, A and C are in a 1 to 2 mean motion resonance because C has a period of 60 years. If the relationship between the orbital period of any two planets can be boiled down to two small whole numbers, they are likely in resonance. Now, we care about resonances because they enhance the mutual gravitational interactions between the bodies and help to stabilize their orbits. Think of it like this. In a 1 to 2 resonance, one planet will complete one orbit for every two orbits of another planet. This relationship is not approximate, it's exactly one orbit for every two. It is this precision that gives rise to the intrinsic stability of mean motion resonances. That said, not all mean motion resonances are created equal. Broadly speaking, the greater the difference between the numbers in the ratio, the less stable the resonance is. 2 to 3 is what's known as a first order resonance and is very stable, differing only by 1. 3 to 5, differing by 2, is a second order resonance and is less stable. Third order resonances will be less stable again, fourth less again, etc, etc. The more stable the resonance, the more objects we can place there. That said, the weaker resonances could well be home to dwarf planets, just their orbital eccentricities will need to be high to compensate for the lack of inherent stability. But what does this all mean for world-building fictional systems? Let's make a plan of a fictional Kuiper Belt. Begin by noting the orbital period of the last gas giant in your system. Your resonant dwarf planets will be in resonance with this object. For convenience sake, I'll say this guy here has a 100-year orbital period. Next up, map out the resonances. Links in the doobly-doo for a big list of them. Choose at will and include a good mixture of stable and less stable resonances. Here are my stable first order mean motion resonances and my less stable second, third, and fourth order resonances. Incidentally, our Kuiper Belt, strictly speaking, is defined as being the region between Neptune's 2 to 3 resonance and 1 to 2 resonance. Pluto, along with 92 other objects, is at 2 to 3, so we call everything there Plutinos, and we call the bodies at the 1 to 2 resonance Tutinos. Perhaps two different stable resonances could define your system's Kuiper Belt. Anyways, convert the ratios to orbital periods, i.e. year lengths, using simple multiplication. Then convert the orbital periods into distances in AU using Kepler's third law, rearranged like so. Where A is the semi-major axis of the orbit in AU, P is the orbital period in Earth years, and M is the mass of your system's star in solar masses. Next, fill the figures in. Here are my orbital periods in Earth years, and here are my distances slash semi-major axes in AU. Next, I'll determine roughly how many objects will be at each resonance. This is important because dwarf planets, by definition, need to have cluttered orbital neighborhoods. Keeping relative stability in mind and choosing numbers at will, I'll go with 50 objects at 2 to 3, 10 at 3 to 5, 5 at 4 to 7, and 15 at 1 to 2. With our mean motion resonances, semi-major axes, orbital periods, and general populations well defined, we need to consider the final two unique parameters, eccentricity and inclination. From studying our Kuiper Belt, I have set myself an orbital eccentricity range up to 0.25 and an inclination range between 10 and 25 degrees. However, given the sheer amount of objects in the Kuiper Belt, some will break these rules. For example, 2005 TV189 has an inclination of 34.5 degrees, and 1996 TP66 has an orbital eccentricity of 0.33. And remember, to stabilize a weaker resonance, increase your orbit's eccentricity. Finally, I'm ready to build my orbit in accordance to the method outlined in a previous video. Links as always on screen or in the doobly-doo. For demo purposes, I chose to construct a Plutino-style orbit in a 2 to 3 mean motion resonance with my outermost gas giant. Stats on this system also in the doobly-doo. Anyways, here's my star, here's my outermost gas giant, and here is my Plutino. Notice how the orbits overlap. Usually this would be a problem, but thanks to the all-important mean motion resonance, the system is odd-looking, yes, but geologically speaking, rather stable. One resonant Kuiper Belt object, done. That's one down. Many, many more left to go. Happy building, everyone.
Good morning, Interweb. I hope you enjoyed this video on resonant dwarf planet orbits. Now, Kuiper Belt dynamics are seriously trippy and I had to leave out a ton of info to keep the video short. Links in the doobly-doo to a whole pile of other reading. Go check it out. As always, if you're interested in more artifact scene content, click the links on screen or in the description. And if you think I earned it, hit the subscribe button. Thank you all so much for watching. Edgar out.